Dear God, we thank you that you have enabled us to come to be together in this snow. Speak to us and speak to each of us by name. Help us to hear and help us to respond to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Live your calling. What on earth am I here for? What on earth are we here for? Today our topic is you are called to belong. You are called to belong. Last week we did you are called to love. And today we are going to look at you are called to love. You are called to belong. God does not intend for you to go through life on your own. God does not want you to be an island on your own. Therefore, you are called to belong. Hebrews 2:10. God is the one who made all things, and all things for his glory. He wanted to have many children share his glory. The second purpose of my life, of your life, is that God formed you and I for his family. We all already know that we are not here by accident. And the reason why we are here is that God formed us, created us, gave birth to us, for us to be his family. Ephesians 1:5, his unchanging plans has always been to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. It's not an afterthought. Cross or Calvary is not an afterthought. Way before creation, that is the plan of God. Who is God's family? God's family is called his church. God's family is called his church. Therefore, this church does not belong to any individual, does not belong to any group, but belongs to God. All saints is God's family. 1 Timothy 3:14-15. Paul wrote to Timothy saying, I'm writing to you so that you know how to live in the family of God. That family is a church. And of the living God, Church of the Living God, the support and foundation of the truth. All saints is a family of the living God. And this is where we get support and foundation for our lives. Why am I here? And not at any other place. I am called to belong to his church, all saints. Ephesians 2:19. So you no longer visitors or strangers. Now you are citizens together with God's holy people. You belong to God's family. That is why you are here. That is why I'm here. The longing for belong is universal. Everybody loves to belong to somewhere. Romans 1:6. You are among those who have been called to belong to Jesus. Earlier in this study, we came across the word calling, purpose, calling. And the Bible is saying to us that we have been called to belong to Jesus. We've been called out of the world. Ecclesia. That's a Greek word. Called out. We've been called out of the world to belong to God's family. Therefore, church, ecclesia, is not an event. It's not a Sunday morning event. Church is not a Sunday morning event. It is a group that I belong to, that you belong to. It's a relationship. Church is a connection. Church is an association of God's children. Church is a covenant of God's people. The benefits of belonging in the Bible can be seen mostly in 5 metaphors. And we'll try to quickly go through them. One is family, temple, body, flock, and God. The first one is family. And as a matter of fact, God never intended his children to be orphans or to be kids. But he wanted them to be in a healthy family. Because in a family, that is where you get to know who you are. In God's family, you learn of your true identity. Most young fashionable people will wear designer clothing by brand names so that they can be associated. Roca, Vans, Forever 21, Gucci, this, that, so that they can belong to a certain class. And our children, I mean, they are very fashionable. Destiny will sometimes ask us to buy Nike. Why Nike? Because all his friends are wearing Nike. He wants to belong to that group of people, to identify with them. Most of our identity comes from our relationships. Son, daughter, husband, wife, grandfather, friend, teammate, pastor. This is where our relationships comes from. And therefore, when you miss any of these, your connections are broken and they are bad. Your identity suffers. When there's a divorce, the family suffers. When you are fired from work, the family suffers. When a spouse dies, someone suffers. And sadly of late, most young people are being brought up without their fathers around. Because most of them are in jail. Some men are in jail. And therefore, they grow up without a father. They grow up without a relationship of having a father. Family then becomes dysfunctional, becomes broken when you don't have a relationship, and sometimes even non-existent. But there is good news for the people of God. Ephesians 2:19 is telling all of us, you and I are members of God's own very family, and you belong in God's household with every other Christian. When you become a Christian, we all become our people. And that family is very important. Because that family is more permanent. That family will last forever. Our unit, father, son, father, mother, wife and children, who will pass away, pass on, pass away. But the church is permanent. That is why we've been in this building for 125 years. Your physical family is a channel to God's spiritual family. The world will use superficial identifiers. He's short, he's black, he's Asian, he's yellow, he's green. People belong to different political parties. People are of different ethnic groupings. People of different nationalities. But when you come to Christ, you are one family. You are all one people. Black, white, green, yellow, short, old, young. We are all one family. What matters is our spiritual identity. And that's the one that will last forever. Hebrews 2:11. Jesus and the people he makes fully all belong to the same family. That is why he's not ashamed to call them his brothers and sisters. One time Jesus was preaching to a crowd of people, and somebody came and brought to him, Jesus, your mother and your family are outside looking for you. And he told them, you know what? You are my brothers and sisters if you do the will of God. Are we sometimes ashamed of our mother or our sister because of something that he's done in the past? Yes, sometimes we get a bit pissed off with some people. But this morning, I want you to be known to all that our sins are not our identity. Our mistakes, our faults are not our identity. By belonging to God's family, we discover our true identity. When you join a gang, or when you want to be you need to have a tattoo. You need to have a tattoo to identify with them. But when you become a Christian, your identification is to be baptized. Oh, I can still wait to go to Israel and be baptized again in Jordan. It is one of my dreams. Acts chapter 2, verse 41. Those who believe what Peter said were baptized and added to the church. Therefore, if you are here and you've not been baptized, please come and see me. We will arrange to baptize you so that you become really part of God's family. The second metaphor is temple. We are a temple. Like a building erected for God's glory. 1 Corinthians 3:16. Don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God and His Spirit lives in you and I? Every time you watch a building, you see that it goes up. It was bare ground, and you see that it goes up. Thousands of different parts come together to make that building. The parts had to fit together. A beam which is half inch sharp cannot support anything. A pipe, a wood, which is one inch too long, cannot connect. To be strong and stable, everything has to connect. If the wood is in the building and it's not connected, it's not part of the building. Therefore, this morning, I want you to look out. Look out. Everybody should please look out. See how beautiful building. Every beam that you see is connected to something. Every pillar, everything that you see here, that is why it's still standing. 125 years. But if the wood and the concrete work were lying apart, they cannot stand. They cannot stand together. Many times in my life, many times in your life, you need other people to hold you together, especially when you have challenges, especially when you have problems, because you cannot be on your own. But when you are in God's temple, you are supported by other people. That is what it's meant to be. Like a strong structure of a building, we support each other and hold each other up. Ephesians 2, 21 going. In Christ, the whole building is joined together, rises to become a holy temple of the Lord. And in Him, you two are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by His Spirit. That is the temple of God. In a building, a disconnected frame with no support and stability will collapse. It will collapse. You are not meant to go through life unsupported and disconnected. We all need spiritual, emotional, and physical support. We need to belong. We all need to belong. We are created to be connected to each other. We are useless to each other when we are disconnected. Romans 1:12. I want us to help each other. The faith we have. Your faith will help me, and my faith will also help you. Where we commit helping each other is a key why we are a temple. In some churches, probably it's something that we should consider here going into the future. When you become a member, you are taken through a membership covenant. That you are not here alone. We are all one and we do things in common. You are indicated to be part of that covenant. Let's look at the metaphor, a body. We have different parts, yes. Fingers, hand, toe, leg, yes. Eyes, eyebrow. We have different parts, all of it. 1 Corinthians 12:27. Now you are a body of Christ, and each of you is a part of it. We are all the body of Christ, and each of us is a part. And as a matter of fact, each of us are a useful part because we all have unique value. Romans 12, 4, just as there are many parts to our bodies, so it is with Christ's body. We are all parts of it, and it takes everyone, not some people, it takes everyone of us to make it complete. For we have different work to do. We have different things to do so that we belong to each other. And each of us needs all others. Yes. Therefore, we have traditional service and have a beautiful contemporary service because we all are different. By coming together, we can all apply our unique body. We are many parts, but everybody needs everybody. We have to work together. We belong to each other. We all need each other. I cannot, you cannot fulfill God's purpose in your life by yourself. If you are not here and I say the Lord be with you, nobody will respond. So I cannot be a priest without you. And I believe that you can also not be precious without me. We all need each other. 1 Corinthians 12. If your foot says, I am not a part of the body because I'm not a hand, that doesn't make it any less a part of the body. And if your ear says, I'm not part of the body because I'm only an ear and not an eye, will that make it any less part of your body? Never be confused. Prominence with significance. Never confuse those two things. Prominence with significance. Ephesians 4, 25. In Christ's body, we are all connected. We are all intertwined to each other. That is the bottom line. We cannot be on our own. We are all together. Especially in this time that we are going through these transitions. Let us continue to be united together because that is what God has meant for us to be in the first place. The fourth metaphor, a flock. A flock. Like a group of sheep banded together for safety. We are put together for safety. Psalm 100 verse 3. God made us. We are his. We are his people. The sheep of his pasture. When you think about sheep, you think about Psalm 23. And I want to read a version, a different version that you are not used to. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. He lets me rest in the medium greens, leads me beside the quiet waters. He gives me new strength. He helps me to honor him the most. Even when walking through the dark valley of the shadow, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me, guarding and guiding all the way. You provide delicious food for me in the presence of my enemy. You have welcomed me as your guest, blessings overflowing. Your goodness and unfailing kindness shall be with me all the days of my life, and afterwards I will live with you forever. That's David talking about the shepherd. Let's see what Jesus himself says in John chapter 10. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. A hired hand runs away because he cares nothing for the sheep. But I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. I lay down my life for my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them. They follow me. I give them eternal life. They shall never perish. No one can ever snatch them out of my hand. Can you hear the care? Can you hear the protection, the promises in these two scriptures? Psalm 23 and John 10. Praise the Lord. In God's flock, we are protected and cared for. We become more confident. We feel secure. We feel safe. your family, you or marriage is being strained. When you are facing personal crisis, you need to talk to people who will step up and patch you up, who will come in and have him in their view, who will come in and hold hands and cry with you and laugh with you. People who walk into our life when everybody has walked out. That is the church. That is what the church is for. The church has two kinds of people that came for them. Two kinds of people. And the first one is the pastor. Pastor. And I want to encourage you that being a priest is a very difficult job. It's a very difficult job. But I love being a priest. That's why I'm here. And I want to encourage you to keep me in your prayers always. Pray for me all the time. 1 Peter 5:2. Take care of God's flock, his people, that you are responsible for. Watch over them because you want to, not because you are forced to. I'm not forced to be here. I had God's calling to come here, and I came. Therefore, I'm here to serve you. I'm here to take care of you. But there's that side of a coin. It can be found in Hebrews 13:17. Obey your spiritual leaders and do what they say. Their work is to watch over you, over your souls, and they know they are accountable to God. Therefore, all I'm saying is that whatever godly teachings, whatever biblical things that I do with you, it is my prayer that not for my sake, but that for the sake of God, you will also obey. What is the scapegoat? The scapegoat in the church is a small group, is a women's fellowship, is a men's fellowship, is a youth group, is a praise team, is a choir, is an altar group. You grow in small groups because you meet regularly and you have conversations. What is God saying to small groups? Galatians 6:2. Share each other's troubles or problems, and in this way obey the love of Christ. Share, share, share. 1 Thessalonians 5:11. Encourage each other and give each other strength. That is what small groups are for. So if you are in this church and you are not part of any small group, I want to encourage you. Join a small group. It is through small groups that we grow. It is through small groups that will build each other and encourage each other. Quickly, let's look at the last one. The garden, the vineyard. It's an organic metaphor. It shows us we grow and become fruitful as a garden. And therefore, Jesus will paint it in a way that becomes more meaningful. John 15:1-5. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener, and you are the branches. In God's garden, my life, your life, becomes productive. I'm able to make contribution. God intended me to do as part of being his church. Just imagine if we go out there to the trees that we have, beautiful trees that we have out there, and break one of the branches and leave them on the ground. In the next branch or two, it will die. But as the branches still hangs on the main tree, year after year, year after year, they'll be here, growing. So Jesus is saying that without him, we can do nothing. But with him, we can produce much fruit. A disconnected branch cannot bear fruit. If you are disconnected from the body of Christ, you cannot bear fruit. You cannot bear fruit. Therefore, this morning, I want us to connect to each other. Yes, we might have differences. We might have different understandings. But when we are coming, connected together, connected to Christ, we will be able to go through all these challenges. In life, we need five basic needs: identity, stability, capacity, security, and productivity. And to fulfill your calling, for me to fulfill my calling, I need power to live on. I need people to live with. I need principles to live by. I need a plan to live out. I need a purpose to live for. Where would you get all these right things? It's only in the church. It's only in the church of Christ. It's only in the church. As I close, let me share just two quick words. To those who are not yet connected, but attend but do not belong, because of very good reasons. Elderly, you live far, long distance, you are single parents, you have a challenging vital situation. I want to tell you this morning, all saints want to be your family. Come, just as you are. Maybe you've been trying to belong, but you never felt belonging to anybody. We want you in this church. You belong here, and we love you. We love you so much. But to most of you in this church, you have been long-term members of this church. You know this. You've been here all your life. You've been here all your life. What can I say to you? All I can say to you this morning is that fall in love again with your church. Fall in love with all saints. Get new energy to do new things. Because all saints is the hope of this world, of righteous time, the community that we are in. It is the only thing on earth that will last forever. This church, if Jesus does not come, will be here forever. Therefore, regardless of what you are personally feeling, or your personal thoughts, fall in love. Fall in love. And I know God will use all of us to bless all of us, because that's what he meant from the beginning. Thank you so much for your kind attention. Let us try and learn the memory verse for the week. And we are going to say it together first with the title. Ephesians 3:21. Let's say it together.
Glory to God, the Church in Christ Jesus, for all time and eternity.
Let's try it one more time. Ephesians 3:21.
Glory to God.